Hello friends, welcome back to my channel Easy Learn for You. In today's session, we are going to discuss Chapter 2 of Class 10th Internet Services and Mobile Technology. So in this chapter, we will learn all about different services which are available online. So these are all the online services which are providing us different applications to work. For using these applications or services, we have to connect with the internet, and that's why these are called online services or web services. The next one is information retrieval. So the process of exploring and retrieving the information from internet is known as net surfing. So when you are sitting on your computer and you are accessing information from internet, it means you are retrieving information from internet or server. For this purpose, we use specialized software, that is web browser, to retrieve information from internet. The next one is email. Email stands for electronic mail, and it is basically used for sending or receiving online messages or letters. So for sending or receiving email, you must have an email ID which you can create on any server like Gmail, Yahoo Mail, Rediff Mail, etc. Email ID has two components. One is username and other one is hostname, separated by @. The username is basically the net name of the user, or you can say it's a name by which the user can be identified on internet, and the server on which you have created your mail account is identified by the host name. So in the given example, Vivek Upadhyay 26 is username, and his ID is created on Gmail server, which is the host name. So these two components are separated by @. So on the left side of @, there is a username which can't be left empty or blank. And on the right side of the @, we have the host server name, which again can't be left blank. Now, what is the difference between replying and forwarding mail? So replying mail means to send or to reply to the same recipient having same mail ID, but with new message. But forwarding a mail means to forward the same message to new recipient. Now, what are the elements of email account? So when you open your mail account, you will see some elements or some folders, each having some different tasks to perform to manage your email account effectively. So these elements are inbox, which contain all the incoming messages, outbox, which contain messages until or unless they are not successfully sent to the recipient. Then sent mail, it contains all the sent messages. Draft, it contains the draft messages which are ready to be sent. Trash, it contains deleted messages, and it works similarly as the recycle bin work for the Windows. Spam, it contains junk emails. Now, in how many formats you can create your email message? So one is plain text format, that is TXT format. And other one is rich text format, that is RTF. So your plain text format does not support any text formatting options such as bold, italic, underline, or any color font. It can have attached pictures or graphics, but they can't or they cannot be inserted. But in case of RTF format, it supports the formatting options such as bold, italic, color font, etc. And picture or graphics can be inserted in your mail. Now, what is the difference between spam and junk mail? Spam is defined as irrelevant or inappropriate messages sent on the internet to a large number of people. But junk mail is the unwanted or unsolicited advertising or promotional material received through mail. These two terms typically used interchangeably. Now, the next topic is very important, that is the structure of email message, and you may see the question in your exam which may be related to individual component or maybe about the overall structure of email message. So let's discuss its component one by one. So the first component is to component. This field contains email address of recipients, means to which you want to send your email. CC and BCC difference is very important. So CC stands for carbon copy, and it contains the address of recipient to whom you want to send a copy of an email message. But in case of BCC, BCC stands for blind carbon copy. This field also contains the list of recipient, but BCC recipients can see 2 and CC addresses, but BCC recipient's name is not visible to others. Means the recipients which are added in 2 and CCC component are not, means can't see the name of BCC recipients. This difference is very important between CC and BCC. Now the next one is subject. This field contains the title of the message, body, it includes the text of the email message, and attachment, you can attach any document with your email message. Formatting, using formatting tab, you can edit your message and make it more attractive. Other options are also available to add some emote icons, to add hyperlinks, etc. And send button, the last component which is used to send your email. So this figure makes you more clear the different components which are working together to send or to create your email. So here are some advantages and disadvantages of email. Email speeds up the workflow process, means you can send your email in a fraction of seconds. Correction can be made quickly, means when you have created your message, you can edit it later on. Email saves paper and printing cost, means no need to take a printout of all the documents. You can save it on your mail account. Multiple copies of a message can be sent to a group of people. Messages can be prepared in advance and save until you are ready to send them. File and images can be attached to an email. So these are some common advantages of using email service. Now disadvantages of email. Email attachment can carry viruses. This is one of the main disadvantage of email, because your mail usually contain virus. So receiving mail is a common source of virus entered in your computer. Limited size of data can be sent, means in case of, for example, in case of Gmail, if you want to send your data, so its size limit is 25 MB. You can't send your mail having size more than 25 MB. Hasty medium to convey emotions. No guarantee that the mail will be read until the user logs on and check email. Now emote icons. Emote icons or smileys are the element that helps you to express your emotions or feelings in your email and text messages. They provide a direct and funny way to express yourself in addition to the word in your message. So some common used smileys are as given in the table. So these are some common smileys. A number of smileys are there which you can use in your email. Now the next one is acronyms. Apart from emote icons and symbols, you can also use acronyms and abbreviations for most frequently used words. So some of the most widely used acronyms are given in the table, and you can use it while sending your email. Now the next topic is search engine. So one of the most important program which makes possible to search anything on the internet. Without search engine, we will not be able to access any content stored on internet. So because of this program, everything is now possible for us to find out on internet. And for searching any information on the internet, we have a number of search engines such as Google, AltaVista, Yahoo, Lycos, Excite, WebCrawler, Khoj.com. So these are some search engine which you can use to find out any information from internet. Now let's see how the search engine works to search any information. The overall search of any content is based on the three important programs. So the first one is web crawler. First, the search engine receives the string to be searched from the web browser and start searching from one database to another. This task is done by the special program called Spider or Scooter, or you can say Robot or Boat, etc. It collects all the searched links and give them to the indexing program. So the next program which start working after the first one is indexing software. It receives all the links from the web browser program and arrange them from most closely matched content to least closely matched content and display on our web browser. And the third program is search algorithm. This program is search algorithm which is methodological search, and it is based on statistical analysis on web pages containing the word. It means these algorithms search the content in the web pages and deliver all the pages containing these words. So it returns a number of links which contains different web pages, and you can access them one by one to access your required content. Now let's see, when you are going to search anything, what are the important tips that you have to keep in your mind for searching your data? So the first one is, do not ask any question, because when you do so, it will split all the words and start searching for each word individually, and the required content will not be received by you. So this is one of the important tip. Now the next one is, surround your query in quotes so that it should be treated as single phrase. You can also place in between, means you can place hyphen or you can place semicolon for the same purpose to search your string. Now the third one is, you can use wildcard character for pattern matching. So if you are writing dir asterisk, so it will return all the words which are starting from dir from internet. Now the next one is, always search your queries in lowercase for more closely matched output. So this is one of the important tips, always search your query in lowercase. Moreover, you can use plus or minus sign to include or exclude any word from your searching phrase. For example, in case of Boston minus university, it will search all the content having Boston word but not university. So in this way, you can exclude or include any specific word from your searching phrase. Now the next topic is, how will you find out the people on internet? So for this purpose, you have a number of websites such as 123people.com, address.com, addresssearch.com, people.com, pq.com. So if you want to search their name, email ID or address, contact number or any of the information of any person, you can use these specific sites. Now the next topic is FTP, that is file transfer protocol, and we have already learned about HTTP protocol, which lets you to access the content in the form of web pages. But in case of FTP, you can transfer your data permanently from your local system to server or vice versa. So it creates a copy from one system to another, and unlike HTTP protocol, when you disconnect your computer from internet, FTP protocol makes available file for you to access easily in your local computer. In other words, FTP makes possible uploading and downloading through internet. It also lets you to transfer file through remote computers. It transfers file between two computers more reliably and efficiently. Some FTP softwares are FileZilla, Smart FTP, Core FTP, etc. Moreover, the system which listens the request and send the file is called FTP server, and the system who sends the request is called FTP client. Now here we have some advantages of FTP. For example, it is fast and efficient. It is used for transferring data in bulk. It has automatic backup data facility. We can work on remote computers for file transferring purpose, and it has some disadvantages such as, it is not secure, it has no encryption of data and may cause spoof attack, etc. Now the next topic is uploading and downloading. So downloading means to transfer a copy of any file from remote computer to your local computer so that after disconnecting from internet you can easily access it. And uploading means to send a copy of your file from your local computer to server so that you can access it easily after connecting through internet at any time and from anywhere in the world. Now the next topic is, what is remote computer or remote device? So it's a computer which is placed far apart from you, maybe in some other city or country, and you can use it in the same way as you are sitting in your own computer by just logging in that system. So some specific protocol works for this purpose, which are also called remote login protocols. The first one is Telnet. So we have already discussed about Telnet. It is a utility of internet that lets you to log in on remote computer system. It gives you a character based terminal window on another system for login, and after that you can start using this system in any ways. And the next one is SSH. That is called Secure Shell Protocol. It is a remote login protocol that logs into remote machine through a shell where all the data between the client and the server is encrypted. So your data is transferring from one system to another, but only after encryption. So when any attack happens in between two systems, your data will be secure because your data is encrypted. Now the next one is SCP, is secure copy. So this protocol allow you to copy file in encrypted form between the two servers or two connected machines over internet. So your data, when you are copying from one system to another over internet, your data will be secure because your data is copying in encrypted form. Now the next one is SFTP, is secure file transfer protocol. It is like FTP, but it is more secure. The data travel through FTP can easily be stolen, but in case of SFTP protocol, all the data and commands are encrypted across the network. Now the next topic is chat. So as you know that today chat is very common medium of communication through various mediums or apps such as Telegram, different messengers such as Facebook Messenger is there, Yahoo Messenger, Gmail Messenger is there. So we can use different messengers also for chatting. WhatsApp is there, Skype is there. So we have different programs or apps through which we are using or we are doing chat. So you can define it as a real-time two-way communication between two computers where there is no delay between sending and receiving messages. We can also share audios, videos, text, images, etc. while chatting. We can have text-based chat where we can send only text, send or receive only text messages, and multimedia chat where we can send multimedia content such as audio or video, graphics, text, images, etc. And moreover, we can also do online chatting by joining chat rooms after logging with your IDs, and you can chat with multiple people simultaneously. So some advantages of chat are we can send emojis and we can send multimedia content. It's a real-time messaging system, and we can have a group chat also. And it is free of cost, the most important thing. Now the next one is some disadvantages. Virus problem is very common, and addiction of chat in all age group of people is very common. Now the next topic is video conferencing. So it is a two-way face-to-face communication between two or more users available at different locations. Each user must have, or group of users which are participating in video conferencing, must have a computer, a camera, a microphone, video screen and sound system along with high speed internet connection. So these are some important components of video conferencing application. Moreover, while using this technology, we can talk face to face in the same way as we are standing in front of each other. Now, some advantages: it reduces travel cost and time. It also increases productivity through collaborative working. We can share multimedia content, and we can also have presentation through different medium and using techniques. And we can also go for business meetings as well. Now, some disadvantages: it may get disconnected at any time when some important meeting is going on, so it may be problematic. And there is no substitute for face-to-face meeting in getting to know someone. And for long time, video conferencing equipment sometimes it may be expensive for you. And the sender and receiver must be present online at the same time. So these are some disadvantages, or you can say some limitations of video conferencing. Now come to the next topic. Now the next topic is e-learning. So electronic mode of delivering learning or training educational programs to the user, or simply we can say online learning is we can say e-learning. And it's an easy way to access knowledge from internet, which can be done anywhere and at any time. And it may be of two types. One is synchronous type, and the other one is asynchronous type. So in case of synchronous type, both the participant and the instructors are present at the real time at the same time. And in case of asynchronous, the participant can do their job online. They can complete their training or work, and without interacting with the instructor, they can complete their course or they can learn online. So e-learning has several advantages, such as we can schedule our course as per our own free time. It reduces travel cost and time. It is self-paced, and we can learn as per our knowledge or as per our understanding. And it makes easy for self-learning using different modes or variety of activities. It also develops self-confidence and knowledge, and also encourages students to take responsibility for their learning. It also has some disadvantages. We must have internet connection, or we may have slow internet connection. So it's another problem that we have internet connection, but the connection is slow, so we will not be able to connect with the internet for learning purpose. So the next one is sometimes we feel isolated from an instructor, and it makes difficult hands-on or lab work in virtual environment. Now the next one is e-banking. So doing banking activities using internet is called e-banking, which is also known as internet banking or online banking or PC banking. Here all the services provided by the bank are available in their online application or website, where the user can do all their work without reaching bank physically. Customers can access e-banking services using PDA or PCs or through ATM, laptops, desktop, etc. Now here the customer can have financial activities as well as non-financial activities through internet, which you can see in the given table. Now see some advantages of e-banking. There is no barrier of using e-banking services, which means you can do your banking activities at any time and from anywhere in the world. It makes the customer flexible of using their services, they can use their financial transactions easily. It has some disadvantages also, such as the problem with internet connection, or it may be difficult for some person or beginners to use or to go through the online transactions when they have a fear to get hacked by unauthorized people over the internet. The same banking features can be used through mobile also, which is known as m-banking or sms banking. Now the next topic is e-shopping. So e-shopping is buying goods or services through internet, is called e-shopping. Here the customer can buy their product from wide range of collections, having books, clothing, household appliances, toys, hardware, software, and health insurance also. We have a wide range of shopping websites such as naptol.com, flipkart.com, yabi.com, homeshop18, amazon.com, etc. Some advantages such as finding a product is much more easier than looking it in the local store. It gives a wide range of collection and it has money back guarantee. It also saves travel cost and time. It has no time foundation, means we can order our product at any time and at anywhere in the world. It also has some disadvantages, such as we have to wait for delivery of a product and we may be a victim of online fraud. Sometimes we have to pay for shipping and the item may not be good as you were assuming. So these are some disadvantages of e-shopping. Now the next one is e-reservation. It's a reservation service through internet where you can reserve or book railway ticket, airways ticket, hotel room, tourist packages, etc. Some e-reservation sites are irctc.com, makemytrip.com, yatra.com, bookingsite.com, etc. It has some advantages as it reduces travel cost and time. No need to stand in a long queue. It's a real-time process and we can compare fare from different sites. It has some disadvantages. We need an internet connection. Virus attack may be a big problem or a common problem, and if the site is not working properly, you will not be able to reserve in any way. Now the next topic is e-group. So online groups of person or individuals who come together for a specific or common purpose, using the best internet communication tools to share their ideas, different opinions, experiences, and to learn from each other. So e-groups are internet-based discussion group where the people of common interest can join and post their messages and can also reply to others. Some common advantages of e-groups: it maintains social relationship, it makes easy for learn or to do discussions, it takes no cost of using it. Even the people of different countries may be combined together to share their ideas and knowledge with each other. It has some disadvantages such as it has no privacy, and someone may share wrong information, and sometimes we may not be able to connect with each other logically. Now the next topic is social networking. It's an online medium to connect with friends, classmates, customers, and clients. Here the people share their events and activities with family, friends, and colleagues. Some social networking sites are Google Plus, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, White Pages, Super Pages, Bing, etc. Some advantages of social networking: we can find anyone who is long lost, or childhood friends or relatives. No special software setting are required, and it's easy to use and cost effective. It connects people with each other and building credibility among the customers also. So some disadvantages. Now some disadvantages: it may be a lack of anonymity and scams and harassment. It may be more time consuming. Now the next one is e-governance. It's an electronic mean of government with the aim of fulfilling the requirement of common man at adorable cost and in fastest possible time. Some e-governance projects in India are Indian Passport Office, Income Tax Portal, Indian Court, RTI Portal, etc. It has some positive impact, such as it reducing waiting time and keeping control on corruption and making easy for people to access the services provided by the government. It has some negative impacts, such as the people in rural area have lack of computerization. They are also not at all aware with the services. Sometimes we may have internet connection issue and lack of knowledge. Now the next one is mobile technology. So nowadays mobile has proved its strength in all the fields and thus increasing its demand day by day. We are using some mobile services such as SMS, which stands for short messaging service, MMS, multimedia messaging service, etc. So the first one is, so let's see what is the difference between the above two. The first one is SMS or a short messaging service is used to send basically a text message up to 160 characters over mobile phone, and the longer messages automatically splits up into multiple messages. And the next one is MMS for the multimedia messaging services, where we can share multimedia content such as audio, video, etc. Now the next topic is generations of computers. So this is the last topic of this chapter. First we will see the generation of mobile technology. To the first one is 1G, which stands for first generation of mobile technology, which are working on analog cell phones. And the 2G generation means the second generation, which was working on digital cell phones, and 3G and 4G are working on smartphones. So here the G in 1G, 2G, 3G and 4G stands for generation, and which differentiate a lot between these technologies. And in terms of speed, you can see in case of 3G, where you can access your data or you can see your downloading and uploading speed, which may vary from 384 kbps to 1 mbps, which is based on the mobility of your device. So if your device is not mobile, means if you are not moving at all, so your speed may be 2 mbps in case of 3G connection. And if you are moving with high speed, so your speed may be 384 kbps. Now the next one is 4G or the fourth generation. It offers an enhanced downloading and uploading speed with better connectivity than 3G. And the 4G network offers a peak data rate of at least 1 mbps for high mobility and up to 1 gbps for low mobility communication. The speed that you receive in your mobile device also depends on the device being used. For example, a 3G phone will work in an area with 4G coverage but will only connect at 3G speed. And similarly, a 4G phone will work in an area with 3G coverage but only connect at 3G speed. So this is all about this chapter, that is Internet services and mobile technology.